Γεια σας, είμαι η Μαρία Γεωργοπούλου, η διευθύντρια της Γενναδίου Βιβλιοθήκης. Since I think the whole event is in English, allow me to speak in English. I'm Maria Georgopoulou. I'm the director of the Gennadius Library here at the American School of Classical Studies. And it is our pleasure and distinct honor to have and host this event here at the American School, an event that is somewhat different from what we normally do. We are an academic scholarly institution. But tonight, the scholarly research goes hand in hand with performance. And in any event, whenever music is involved, and whenever Christopher King is involved, things become quite interesting and quite rich in terms of thinking about topics and events and history of music. So I understand that today is one of three lectures thinking and starting to talk about the history of Jewish music in Greece. And since I don't know much more than what you know about the event, I would let the organizers and the people who are in charge really move on with the program. And again, thank you very much for being here, and I hope that all the events have a great success. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to those of you sitting in this beautiful auditorium, but also those watching us from home. My name is Marianna Skylakaki. I'm editor-in-chief and CEO of Athenea, and I have the great honor and pleasure to be moderating tonight's event, tonight's lecture by the great Christopher King, an American musicologist, a sonic archaeologist, as I've heard you refer to yourself at times, an award-winning producer, and of course, a beloved figure here in Greece due to your research and your exploration of the Greek folk musical tradition, in particular, the folk music of Epirus. Now, I myself share part of that heritage. Both my mother and my grandmother were born in Ioannina, so I feel a great sense of anticipation for tonight's event. And this journey that we're embarking on history, this journey on the past, and the unsung history of Greek Jewish women in the early 20th century. So with no further delay, the floor is yours, Christopher, for your introduction.
Thank you, Marianna, for that overwhelming introduction. I didn't know I was beloved.
Truly beloved.
Well, I mean, I'm honored to be in this academic scholarly arena where I'm able to present topics which are thoroughly researched but also presented with the heart, because that's what music is. It's our way of expressing our heart. I am a musicologist. I use the 78 RPM disc as a means of time travel. In other words, this disc, which is fragile and about 100 years old, combined with this machine, it takes us back in time. We hear the echoes of eternity through such a thing. The other thing I like to do is I like to tell stories through these discs. And so in that way, I'm just a simple storyteller. I want to introduce us to the topic this evening, and then Marianna will work with me to partially tell this story. No matter how much time we spend here, we're not going to be able to tell half of the whole. I want to start not with the Maltic music and not with the Jewish contributions to it, but with this phenomenon of commercial recording. Popular vernacular music was recorded as early as the 1890s in the United States. At the turn of the 20th century, the sale of phonographs and their discs was strictly a commercial enterprise. It had nothing to do with preserving culture. It had everything to do with making money. Mm-hmm. The discs and the players were furniture. And we'll see in the next picture here that this is a cavernous structure at the Sears and Roebuck building holding hundreds of thousands of 78s. Even though Greek music was captured in studios in Athens and Thessaloniki, Izmir and Istanbul at the turn of the 20th century, it was really in America that the recording explosion of Greek folk music took place. For instance, by the 1940s, Greeks were the 13th largest immigrant population in America, but Greek records accounted for nearly one-fourth of the total sales of all records. This disproportion is due to the relative affluence of Greek Americans, their love of their home music, and the sheer number of Greek recordings being made. It was in America that Greeks, especially Greek women, had an almost unheard of opportunity to create and curate their own music and their own record labels. The ethnic diversity and representation of female musicians in traditional Greek music is a shared part of Greek and American history, because it took place in America, this explosion, this interest in Greek music. For instance, a woman, Madame Koula, Koula Anthopoulos, established her own 78 RPM labels, Panhellenon and Orpheum, prior to 1918. These were the first independently owned record labels, and her picture will come up next. Mm-hmm. She recorded over 200 sides and also performed with two of the best-selling Greek female artists, Maria Papagika and Amalia Vaka. Mm-hmm. Before World War II in America, nearly every style of Greek demotic music, including music from Epirus, from Pontic musicians, Macedonian and Cretan, were recorded and sold. It was not until the late 1920s that major labels in Athens started to record and issue the folk music of the people. It was within this context that truly multicultural music was being recorded in Greece. Mm-hmm. And one of the catalysts that drove this music were the Greek musicians, mm-hmm. the Greek Jewish female musicians.
Now, a first question that pops to mind is, how important were these patterns of immigration in creating Greek folk music, or what we understand now as Greek folk music?
It's a carrot and the stick type of phenomenon. Mm-hmm. The Greek immigrants came to America and they longed for their home music, mm-hmm. but many of the musicians preferred to stay in the urban centers of New York. There they played in the cafes, mm-hmm. and in the restaurants, and they made music on the side. They made these discs on the side. And suddenly the American record labels realized they had this phenomenon on their mm-hmm. hand. They could make a lot of money off mm-hmm. of immigrants. Mm-hmm.
What was the audience of this music once it traveled to America?
Well, oddly enough, a lot of the music crossed the Atlantic back again, mm-hmm. not in the form of the musicians, but in the form of the discs. Mm-hmm. Music would be recorded in New York or Chicago, and then immigrants would send recordings back mm-hmm.
to their families.
Yeah. And so it's not surprising for me to find American press discs mm-hmm. in collections here in Athens. Mm-hmm. And then when you think about it, I mean, I've now moved here. I'm now living in Konyaca. Mm-hmm. Some of the discs in my collection have probably crossed the Atlantic 6 or 8 times, leaving an enormous carbon footprint yeah. that I'm responsible for.
Yeah. That's one side of the story, but was there an influence in the way in the music by the fact that they went to the U.S.? Did their music change these
of course,
musicians that
of
traveled
course.
From
Greece? You know, for instance, Rembetiko, mm-hmm. which was a phenomenon split between the sort of Asia Minor style and then the style that developed in Athens and the urban areas on the mainland, it took on a different flavor in America, and it I think you would say it took on less of a bouzouki type characteristic.
Okay.
It transformed, it became something distinctly mm-hmm. Greek-American.
I see. Now, was there ever a linguistic barrier? And that's a bigger question, I suppose. Is there a linguistic barrier when it comes to folk music and our ability to appreciate a tongue that perhaps we don't know and we don't follow as much?
I don't know. I mean, I obviously I can't understand the lyrics one little bit.
Yeah.
But it grabs me the way in which it's conveyed. Mm-hmm. You know, music is ultimately the most basic language we have. And so when a piece conveys bottomless sadness, you're going to feel sad when you hear it. You don't have to know the words.
So it transcends the language barrier.
It transcends the linguistic barrier, mm-hmm. yes.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Now, you know, I have a bit of a basic question because I want us to set the stage a little bit for this particular project and to understand your methodology, how you go about making these connections and proceeding with this exploration, you know, as a sonic archaeologist. Do you dive very, very deep into the history and the traditions of particular communities to truly appreciate their music? How do you go about it? What's your methodology?
I don't know if there's a methodology.
I come from a social scientific viewpoint, so I always look for these things.
It's much more of a madness or a mania than it is something rational. But, you know, you hear something and it puts its claws in you, for instance, the Miraloya of Ipiros. And for me, I hear it and I understand there's a purpose, there's mm-hmm. a function to the music. Mm-hmm. What is that purpose or function? It's inaccessible to me as a 21st century American. Mm-hmm. And so I have to understand. Mm-hmm. Not only do I listen to it and then I understand the structure, but then I go to the villages, I go to where the music comes from, I interview the musicians, mm-hmm. I interview the villagers. Mm-hmm. I try to find all the connections between everything because everything is connected. And unless you understand this interconnectedness, you don't understand anything.
You don't understand it, yeah. What is it about listening to music that was written and performed in the past today that makes it so special in your view?
I think it's because it's no longer dynamic.
Mm.
It's fixed in a very certain space and time, because things do change. The way in which a Miraloy was played 100 years ago is not the way in which it's played now.
Mm-hmm.
And perhaps the purpose has mutated, adapted, atrophied, grown, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
The thing about the 78 RPM disc, it's a fixed point of reference. This is how it sounded then.
Now, trying to dig a little bit deeper into this particular project, and since you mentioned Miraloy, what is the connection between your previous work and this particular project, Greek Jewish women in the early 20th century? Is it part of a larger journey or narrative, or do you see it as a more separate chapter?
I see it as an ongoing development of the same kind of work, because the book that I wrote was basically an exploration for not only why we make music, mm-hmm. but also what purpose did this specific music serve at this time. And so taking that as a gateway drug, so to speak, I want to understand how music functions among people. And when you start to sample music from all over Greece or the Southern Balkans, you realize patterns. And in this instance, the pattern of these Jewish influences on Greek music, the Ashkenaz, the Sephardic, the Romaniote, and then the musicians who performed it. To me, this is a very interesting mm-hmm. phenomenon.
Mm-hmm. Now let's talk a little bit more about these women that are at the heart of this exploration.
Okay, I'm gonna read just a little bit here, and then I'm gonna read a short piece from my book to introduce our first artist.
Mm-hmm.
Greece, especially in Thessaloniki and in Ioannina, was a cosmopolitan, thriving, multicultural country. There were communities of Slavs and Turkish people, Aramanians and Mediterranean people, and among these we would have found tens of thousands of Jewish people, mainly of Sephardic, which is the Spanish Ladino language, and of Romaniote. Now, I want to read a short section from the book that I published a few years ago. And this is, I didn't realize it, but you don't know these things until after they're published, that this fits perfectly as an introduction to the topic.
Mm-hmm.
In this chapter, which is a chapter about Alexis Zumbas, one of my fascinations, this violin player who constructed the saddest piece of music ever recorded, I talk about the Romaniotes of Ioannina. And in order to describe this, for the typical American, I had to set up a literary parallelism. And in this case, I talk about the writer Bruno Schultz. Mm-hmm. He was a short story writer from Poland. He was an Ashkenazi Jew. And as just a simple aside, when I gave my manuscript to my editor, W.W. Norton, and he read the chapter, and he's Ashkenazi Jewish, mm-hmm. and he said, there was a third tribe of Jews? So without further ado, I'll read this short little section here. Bruno Schultz and Amalia Vaka were different kinds of Jews. Schultz, like most European Jews, was Ashkenazi. The Ashkenazim were part of the exodus from the Middle East that migrated north, living variously in Germanic lands, Russia, Poland, and other areas, moving in response to oppressive conditions. While not speaking German, Russian, or Polish, or some other language, the Ashkenazim spoke Yiddish, a German dialect. Another Jewish lineage, Sephardim, are Jews who were expelled from Spain after 1492. The tongue they shared among themselves was Ladino, a derivative of Spanish. Many Sephardic Jews settled in Thessaloniki, the largest port city in northeastern Greece, making it the Jerusalem of the Balkans. Amalia Vaka belonged to a third branch, a distinct and ancient community of Jews. She was a Hellenized Jew, a Greek-speaking Romaniote, and the robust center of this culture was Ioannina. Hellenized Jews traversed mainland Greece nearly 300 years before Christian converts landed on its shore. Alexander the Great likely had Hellenized Jews among his train of soldiers and craftsmen as he advanced the Greek Empire. Apocryphally, the Romaniotes of Ioannina are said to have been slaves on galleys that ran ashore along the Ionian beaches of Epirus. Released and granted freedom, they moved inland to Ioannina. When Byzantine rule filled the vacuum created by Rome's decline, most slaves experienced a change in status. Among these would have been the Greek-speaking Jews. And then I jump forward just a small section. Mm-hmm. From the exterior, there is little to distinguish a Romaniote from a Greek Christian. Artemis Miron, one of the last surviving Jews born in Ioannina from before the Holocaust, said in an interview, I want to tell you that outside of our homes, there was no difference between the non-Jews and us. We studied together in the same schools with the non-Jews, we spoke Greek like them, and we dressed like them. Outside our homes, there was no difference between Jews and non-Jews pertaining to business, neighborliness, to education. But in our homes, we strictly observed our Judaism.
Mm-hmm. It's fascinating how much of an ancient tradition that is, and how much it goes back into time. But I do wonder how big of a part religion was in the music that was created by these women at that point in time.
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, as we will see, none at all.
None at all. Okay,
I mean, I would say that the religiosity has always been in the background. It's an ethnic component, it's a religious component, but it always floats in the back. Mm-hmm. What really floats up front is artistry and Greekness.
Mm-hmm. But were there many Greek women folk singers at the time? Was it something common, or was it something that these Greek Jewish women were able to do, perhaps because of their religious background?
Mm. Well, I mean, I think that the three women that recorded commercially that mm-hmm. we were talking about this evening represent sort of a tip of the iceberg mm-hmm. of the amateur scene. Mm-hmm. There were many, many different people playing, but there's also another aspect of this, that in the early 20th century, to be a woman and to perform, to mm-hmm. sing, was actually not so good socially.
Yeah, there was quite a stigma attached to it.
A huge stigma. And so when these women stepped forward to record their voices, they were also sealing their own fate. They mm-hmm. knew that they would, in essence, be marginalized mm-hmm. simply by their own expressions. Mm-hmm. So I'd like to start our presentation, this next part, with talking about Amalia Vaka. And this is a catalog page from an American Victor catalog showing her very young picture. It's the earliest picture that we have besides one painting, this hand-colored picture of her and her mother. Well, before I describe her, I would like to play a recording by her. And because I'll butcher this beautiful language of yours, can you read that?
Εσύ κοιμάσαι με τη μαμά σου.
Yeah, you sleep with your mother.
Yeah, exactly.
I like the title.
Yeah, it's interesting.
So this is Amalia Vaka. This is recorded in 1927. And the violin player on this is my dear, dear departed friend, Alexis Zumbas. Mm. Okay, we need sound.
What is the date, you said?
1927.
Clapping at some point. There's a very strong participatory element to folk music, and I know you're an avid collector of old discs, but what gets lost in recording, do you think, compared to the live performance?
I don't think anything gets lost.
Nothing? Okay.
I mean, that's why I love it. It does capture this almost like the way a photograph negative captures a moment in time. Mm-hmm. All the nuances, all the errors, all the mistakes, the hairs, the filaments. It's all captured with the recording, including the enthusiasm.
Clearly.
So I'm going to read a little bit about Amalia, and then we will discuss, and then move to the next disc. Mm-hmm. Amalia Vaka, maiden name Mazel Tov Matsa, was born in 1897 in Ioannina, Ypres. In 1912, at the age of 15, she moved by herself to New York City. 2 years later, she married another Romaniote who had immigrated from Ioannina, and they had two children. In the early 1920s, she began to sing professionally in the Café Amanès of New York. Shortly afterwards, she made her first 78 RPM recordings, Greek songs for the Greek record company and Turkish songs for Parsekian record company. Mm-hmm. And you'll see in a second the diversity of labels that she recorded on. Over the course of her long career, she recorded over 46 sides, most of which were issued before World War II. She traveled and performed extensively along what I call the Theta circuit. the clubs and venues stretching from Boston to New York City to Chicago and Detroit. Mm-hmm. In the 1930s and 40s, she was often found with Yorgos Katsouros. And in the late 1940s, she recorded for Ajden Aslan. He was an Albanian musician in New York who recorded a broad repertoire mm-hmm. of Balkan material. She moved in 1974 to Tarpon Springs, Florida mm-hmm. to live with her daughter after Chicago's Greek town had been dismantled. She died 5 years later in 1979. And the thing that really draws me to Amalia, and I say it in a very friendly way, mm. was my equal fascination with Alexis Zumbas. Okay.
And their connection.
Because wherever Alexis was found, mm-hmm. Amalia was sure to be found too.
Now, that's very, very interesting, this connection between Alexis Zumbas and Amalia. Do you have some examples of that that you'd like to share? Of that, did they record together? How did they influence each other?
Well, I mean, they were one of her most moving performances, which was the one that we played at the very beginning with the video, mm-hmm. To me is one of the most perfect recordings from that time period, because they're both, she's singing at the height and at the depth of her passion, and Zumbas is pushing her along, propelling her, almost not like they're musicians, but like brother and sister mm-hmm. in a way.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, their stories, which I relate in the book, it shows that at a certain time period, these musicians in an America recording, they realized that it wasn't so much that they were playing Greek music, it was they were playing music for people from the Levant.
Okay.
You know, they sang in Turkish and Armenian, they sang in Albanian and in Greek, and they played this cross repertoire. So in a way, in New York City, it was this experiment with the melting pot.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So we have influences from the entire Levant, as you said.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And it was captured.
And the audience again is very multicultural, right?
Yeah, because in America, I think that you, when you're a recently minted immigrant, mm. you really weren't allowed to have prejudices.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
You know, you went to the one cafe, and yeah. the music that they played was
bonded
familiar to
all
you.
Of these different
yeah.
people.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's really, really interesting. Regarding the other two recorded artists that left their mark, would you like to share some particular stories about them?
Well, first let me play a 78 mm-hmm. by Rosa Eskenazy,
yes.
and then I'll read a little bit, and then we can talk.
Absolutely.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Sorry.
Μελαχρινό καλαματιανό. Rosa Eskenazy.
This is one of her relatively rare examples of demotic music. Mm-hmm. She was more known for her Asia Minor style. This is a solid piece within the sort of mainland tradition.
Mm-hmm.
Because
Now, this piece of music was recorded in Greece, right?
This was recorded in Greece in 1935. Mm-hmm. But this particular disc was pressed in America and marketed in America, mainly to Greek-American immigrants. But this copy turned up here in Athens. So it crisscrossed the Atlantic again.
Made the trip.
Mm-hmm. So I'll read a little bit about Rosa, and then we can talk about her. Mm-hmm. Rosa Eskenazy was born sometime in the mid-1890s. I like the sound of that. She was very slippery about her age. I mean, I think as she reached the ripe age of 92 to 95, she was going backwards in time. She was 62, 60, 58. She was born in Istanbul into a Sephardic Jewish family. When just a child, the family moved to Thessaloniki, which was undergoing an economic boom, particularly with the merchant classes of Sephardim. As a teenager, she started to sing in Turkish in the local clubs and eventually moved to Athens in the late 19-teens. In Athens, she sang in Greek, Turkish, and Armenian, eventually gaining the attention of Vasilis Tumbarakis, the artist and repertoire man for Columbia Records. With his assistance, in less than two decades, she recorded over 300 sides of demotic and Asia Minor style music, popularizing the Smyrna style rimbetico. And we'll see some of the labels come up. Before the outbreak of World War II, she toured extensively the Mediterranean and Southern Balkans. Now, this is also apocryphal. She survived the war with a fake baptismal certificate and with the aid of her German lover and her son.
I've read that, yeah.
After the war, she acquired a professional contract through her friend Minos Matsas, which revitalized her career, the second revitalization. Shortly afterwards, she made multiple tours of the United States, from what I've heard, over a dozen, and even recorded for Ajdan Aslan, the Albanian record producer in New York. Important to note, I think, the 78 RPM discs of Eskenazy sold nearly three times the number of copies in the United States than they did in Greece.
Throughout the 60s and into the 1970s, she appeared on television and was enjoying a relatively busy performance schedule, her third revitalization. She died in 1980, between the age of 60 and 102. Yeah.
So a very long and fascinating life.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I think maybe she might have had a heavy hand when her autobiography was written.
I see. Talking about Rosa Eskenazy, are there commonalities? And perhaps talking about all of these women, are there commonalities between other female artists that you've researched throughout your exploration?
Of course,
especially US artists, because you had quite a focus on folk artists, female folk artists from the US folk tradition, right?
Yeah, I mean, to me, one of the more interesting parallelisms mm-hmm. is that. These women in Greece, they basically, in a way, sacrificed their personal reputation mm-hmm. for their professional desire to sing.
For their craft. Yeah.
In America, it was almost the exact opposite.
Really?
For instance, one of the most prolific recording groups, the Carter family, composed of two women, Maybelle and Sarah, mm-hmm. They recorded like over 500 sides, mm-hmm. and they actually elevated their status. Mm-hmm. You know, they became women folk singers. Mm-hmm. The interesting parallelism is that I think people copied the Carter sisters, the Carter family, whereas the Rosa Eskenazy, Maria Papagika, and Stella Haskil, mm-hmm. it spurned other women to sort of like express their voice, and it was never the same. Mm-hmm. The embellishments were never the same. It was not a copying act. It mm-hmm. was I want to express my own voice.
An evolution, I suppose.
Yeah, an evolution.
Of that music. Talking about Stella Haskil, she's the third artist that we're going to explore tonight, correct?
Yes. So I'll play one of her 7/8 discs. This is relatively late. This mm-hmm. is after World War II. Mm-hmm. And also it's one of her more well-known numbers.
Kérome, kérome.
Και ποιος θα με γλιτώσει.
Now I'll read just a little bit about Stella. Stella Haskil was born in 1918 in Thessaloniki to a working-class Sephardic family. She had a prolific recording career, singing songs with Vamvakadis, Tsatsanis, and Hatsi Christos, as many others. Several of her performances became cornerstone rebetiko pieces. She also traveled to America to perform in the early 1950s, due to the popularity of her American issue 78s once again, but recorded to Athens because of her health. She died at the tragically young age of 36 in 1954.
So a very different trajectory to Eskenazy, a shorter time recording.
Yeah, it was snuffed out. Her life was snuffed out by her health problems.
But she truly left her mark, right?
Yeah, I mean, I think actually her repertoire is more well remembered than the other two women before him who recorded four times as much.
It's very, very interesting. At this point, I think I'd like to open it up to our audience a little bit and see if they have some questions for you.
Sure.
Would that be okay?
Yeah. Do
we have a microphone that can go around? I think we do, right? Whoever would like to pose a question can raise their hands and we can circulate the microphone.
Shall I tell you in Greek? It is very short.
Sure, of course.
Chris, you mentioned that they sing sides.
Sides.
Each side of the record would be a different person?
Most of the time. I mean, yeah, sometimes it would be Stella Haskil. Most of the time it'd be her two-sided records. But oddly enough, or maybe not oddly enough, with most of the recordings issued of Rosa Eskenazy, the flip side would be Rita Abazi. I'm not exactly sure what explains it other than the fact that maybe in America they thought that they could sell more copies by, I don't know, duping the listener.
Is there something particular about these women being Jewish? Something that binds them?
I think certainly within their own cultural place, you know, them being Jewish and being Greek would have really how they would have wanted to situate it themselves. I am Greek and I am Jewish at the same time. There's nothing about their delivery, nothing about what they sing, nothing about from where they sing that colors that, though. There's nothing Jewish about the way in which they sing, the way that they express themselves on disc. I mean, I guess maybe what I think is worth remembering, or at least exploring, is this concept that, you know, one can contain within oneself multitudes. You can be Jewish and you can be Greek, and it's the same thing, it's joined together. And it's maybe it's a way for us to appreciate this concept of cultural amnesia, historical amnesia, that we all have, not just Greeks, but Americans too, that we tend to think of a music in a very national way, when really, 100 years ago, it was not. It was in the process of becoming. It was becoming something.
And why is overcoming cultural amnesia so important today, in your opinion?
Well,
in
order to combat everything from racism to sexism to economic disparity, I mean, it's necessary for us to be able to reflect upon the past and see the nuances that are at play there, how things construct and how they evolve. Mm-hmm. You know, our identities are not stamped and unfixed. They're constantly changing, and they come from a changing place.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I think we had a question there.
Yes, I wonder, since so much of the development of the recordings and so on took place in the United States in the early days, and there was, of course, a very dynamic music scene of many different types of music in New York and Chicago and so on. Was there any type of interaction between the development of Greek music and Greek recordings and other musical traditions that were also developing at the time in the United States?
Of course. I mean, there was, because in the studios at that time, you would have one Greek musician, such as Alexis Zumbas, come in, and he would have somebody playing the san, who would be Armenian, but then you would have a person playing the bowed contrabass, who was from Brooklyn, you know, like a seventh generation American. And of course, these things, they tended to like tinker with the way that music develops, because music is just an interesting thing we do with air. You introduce other influences and suddenly you get a different result. I mean, I think possibly one of the best examples was this recording that I'm not going to play because I don't have it here, but of Miserlou by a Greek musician whose name on the label was Jack Gregory. But that song later developed into a rockabilly classic. You know, it was copied by everybody. It was in the film Pulp Fiction. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So, you know, you have these instances where repertoire and style, they get melted together.
Cross-fertilization.
In America, yeah. Just as much as they were melted together here in Greece. Mm-hmm,
mm-hmm. Do you have any examples of them being melted together here in Greece, for example? I remember you talked about this part in Karangiozi.
Right, right. Well, I mean, there are these interesting avenues that I've discovered, and also other scholars have discovered, that things that we identify with as being solely and strictly Greek actually have origins in Turkish melodies, as well as in Jewish melodies, such as the Greek puppet music. Mm-hmm. Another interesting thing is this development of a instrumental shepherd's air that we know as skaros in Ibros, mm-hmm. but beforehand it was recorded as doina. Mm-hmm. Doina. Well, doina is a Romanian Jewish, it's an Eskenaz melody. Mm-hmm. And so somehow this piece of music came down and put itself into Greece, and then it developed on its own. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
You said that their Jewish origin did not add something different to their interpretation of the traditional folk songs, did not influence their interpretation. How were they accepted by the Greek society? Was the acceptance, was there any thing different because of their Jewish origin or not?
Well, I can only comment upon Rosa Eskenazy and Stella Haskil that the answer was no. I don't think that there was anything resembling racism or this suspicion of their otherness that undermined their recording careers or made them anything different from any other performer in the studio. Mm-hmm. I mean, with Amalia Vaka, it's more nuanced. I think that she almost had to come to America to record. And I see at the same time that, once again, after researching the life of Alexis Zumbas and interviewing people that recalled her and recalled him, there was prejudice. There was. And I think that it was a unique form here. It was not so much identification as being Jewish as it was being other, as being labeled an outsider. You're not exactly Greek. You're something makes you a little different. At least in my research with Amalia, that's what I found.
Mm-hmm. I think there was a question over there.
Thank you both for the excellent presentation. It seems to me that this whole business about discs is an individualized or collective, however we look at it, endeavor. Musicians go to a studio and they record, and then this record is heard in private environments or socially in collective settings. So I'm wondering if you have done any research, not so much about the production of records, but with reference to the sociology of listening to records.
Oh, that's a very, very, very good question. And I think that's a field that's ripe for research because, well, I mean, I could spend hours up here, but then somebody'd have to bring me some tzipurol to get me through the evening. But when I find stashes of 78s here in Athens, they belong to a family. They belong not only to the members of the family, but to their parents and their great-grandparents. The originators, the original purchasers of the discs had them, so they were intact. And there's a great sociological story that could be told with how things are bought, consumed, and then passed down, and then accumulated. And it shows, in a way, these changes that took place in Greece over the last 100 years, because most of these discs are 100 years old. You can see a family acquiring 78s from one generation to the next and putting them aside. This tells something about the family, but it also tells a larger story about Greece.
And these discs tend to find their way into your hands these days, right?
People fortunately. Yeah. Fortunately, yes.
Yeah. Do we have any more questions?
I would like to ask whether you were able to spot out any other Jewish musicians recording Greek Jewish musicians in the States, because there's it seems that there was quite a big tradition here, which was almost totally lost during the war.
No, I was not able to do any interviews with any surviving musicians. The interesting thing, because there's lots of fascinating stories that are interwoven between Ashkenaz, Sephardim, and Romaniote Jews and the music of Eastern and Central Europe, is that one of the most famous klezmer musicians, Dave Tadas, he actually was issued on Greek labels under a pseudonym playing klezmer music, and his records sold very well in Greece. And it makes me curious, like what the listening community was like in Athens, but also in Ioannina and Thessaloniki, that would have consumed this music that has similarities, but they're not the same. There are differences.
Mm-hmm. I think we have time for two more questions.
Okay.
Yeah. I think there was a question in the back that I missed. No? Okay. So that concludes the Q&A part of the evening. Thank you for your questions. Before we move on to the next bit, I have one final question on my part. And that is, you know, you love Greek folk music. You've spent a big chunk of your life now devoted to Greek folk music. Was there anything in your life prior that could have prepared you for how big of a part Greek folk music would play in your life's work?
No, I was clueless.
Okay.
I mean, when you really truly fall in love, you don't really know much about your partner. And that was certainly the case when I bit off the Southern Balkan footprint, Greece, Southern Albania, this whole region. Mm-hmm. I had no idea how vast and deep it ran. Mm-hmm. And so, but in a way, that's actually nice because, you know, I'm never going to be bored.
that's for sure. Thank you very, very much on my part. I think we have the musical portion of the evening next.
Yeah, right? we have some beautiful live music for you that we're going to listen to, and then we'll close up.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much.
είναι ταπεινή κι ο αέρας την ταράζει. Η μάνα κάνει το παιδί και ο ξένος τα αγκαλιάζει. Αχ, αλλή, μόνο σε μένα πόριξα, σέβδα σε σένα. Και τα βουνά και εκείνη που τα είδα χαριτενή τα νιάτα σας, δεν τα έχει κάψει μοίρα. Αχ, χαλασιά μου, χαλασιά μου, ποτίσω μέλι, γιατί την ταξιδεύουνε κορμάκια σαν αγγέλη. Αχ, τι θα κάνω, πως θα γένω, φαρμάκωσε η έρημη αγάπη. Αχ, τι θα κάνω, πως θα γένω, αγαπώ και δεν κερδένω. Thank you. Ρέμα, άιντε με στο ρέμα.
Έλα εδώ κοντά μου.
Αν κάνω το πουλά μου, εμορφή μικρούλα μου.
One more, the perfect closing to a very musical evening.
Στα πανά γίνω σε σμερναίοι κοτέκε. Άιτε να έρχονται τα χανομάκια να φουμαρούν αργέλε. Thank you. χτυπούνε στη γουνιά. Άιντε το πόνο και την οκλέγει. Τη μανούλα του γυρεύει.
I guess that wraps up this evening, right?
It does, in the most musical way, I suppose. Yeah.
It's traditional for people to thank people, right?
Yes, we
okay.
do that.
Okay, yeah. This would have not been possible without you.
Thank you so much, Christopher. Thank
you. And I have to thank the wonderful people who have invited me again, Maria Yoropulo, Maria Smalley, and my friend Andrea Zumanakis, to come here to this wonderful venue, my favorite venue in all of Athens. I have to thank Kafka, and people there who know who Kafka is will know who she is. She made this possible as well. And then sitting in the front row, Eleni Alexaki of the U.S. Embassy, I must thank. And least but not last, Sebastiana and Heidi of Bespoke, who made this entire thing possible. Thank you.
Thank you very much to both our audience here and at home. And I think that concludes this evening. It was a pleasure having this conversation with you, Christopher. It was truly, I was definitely outside of my comfort zone, but I very much enjoyed it.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.